We were wanting to get more of that kind of thing in anyway. Well, it's a lonely road that you
have chosen. Morning comes. It sounded quite dancey, and lots of pumping 808 kick drums.
And then we set about trying to work out how to play it.
It was impossible to play any of the songs live.
Endless kind of squeaks and squiggles and bleeps and blips.
Gradually we thought we just needed to strip back stuff because Tom was doing lots of things while we were playing and playing acoustic guitar.
There was just no room for any passion in the playing really at all.
So we had to kind of search for a way of simplifying everything and making it sound a bit more organic and real.
That I think was when we hit upon the idea of using the piano, the proper CP70 piano, as the kind of main instrument of the band.
So this is the biggest gig we've ever done.
Let's also make it the best.
God.
It's the biggest gig we've ever done. I mean, it could be the best as well. Hopefully.
Actually, I thought I'd be more nervous than I am. Because it's massive. It's really big. I mean, it's really, really big.
That's where you need to be looking.
Back middle.
Oh, we love to do a show. We love to do a show on Broadway. Broadway, off of Broadway. La 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 Broadway.
Oh God, I hate these shows that are so nerve-wracking.
There's no reason to be so nervous.
Everyone got their pack?
Found that sound, the piano, that we were happy with. We went out and played a couple of acoustic shows.
We'd had such a sort of miserable time in 2002. We were a bit fed up with just sort of fiddling around with demos and not really playing live, so we decided to just go out and we did a couple of acoustic shows.
We did a couple of gigs and one of them was the 12 Bar Club, which is where Simon Williams from Fierce Panda saw us.
I remember him saying that night it would be great to do a single. It was great. We went home very happy.
They released about 500 copies, I think it was, and Steve Lamacq heard it and he'd been to a gig and played it on his Radio 1 show, made it his single of the week.
The first time you hear yourself on the radio, it's such an amazing sensation.
That basically felt like the breakthrough for us.
Because it was the first real evidence that maybe we would get somewhere.
After that, we never looked back.
We were just incredibly happy.
We just hired a van, the three of us, and went off. We played sort of 15 gigs around the country. Really great fun.
We were suddenly a proper functioning band, you know, who were making records and touring, you know.
All those places that we used to play as a guitar band, we were now playing with just the three of us and the piano and everything, and it was feeling really good.
And people started coming to the gigs because they'd heard our name on the radio and they'd heard the song. Basically, because of that, record companies just said, they wanted to sign us.
Having felt so unwanted for so many years, it just felt like pure comedy to have all these people phoning up.
So it just turned into the sort of classic label bun fight.
In the old days, I'd just write a song and churn out a song and I'd finish it, and it kind of seemed to be easy most of the time. Whereas now, with each song, you feel like it's a kind of a potential, you know, it's a potential album song rather than just a song that I've written.
Got half a great song. What's that? Song called The Frog Prince.
Whenever I sit down, because I feel under so much pressure, I get impatient. If I don't write something brilliant in half an hour, then I'll start thinking that I'm never going to write a good song again, and that in turn just means that I feel under even more pressure, and you just can't write under pressure like that.
Yeah. What are you going to do?
I used to have that luxury where I was writing every day. And now, when you get a chance to sit down at a piano, you feel like you know you've got 2 hours to sit down and play the piano, and you better write something good.
I thought I'd get loads done out here, but it's just been completely hopeless.
That's quite a good view there, Ed. Look, the industrial,
the commercial...
The industrial commercial.
Yeah. You're not really looking in the right direction, but you're so bad. Over there! There's New York! That's a lake!
Got it! Oh, I got the shot. Oh.
It's
Tom, I'm trying my best.
You want to get one of those steady cam harnesses? I'd love to see you walking around with it.
So, what do you guys think? Ooh, what a nice shot this is. Where you said you'd wait
for me, and I waited. What are you writing, Tim?
Just working on a demo.
It's a song I wrote about a friend of mine. Split up with his girlfriend for many years.
Who was the friend?
I don't think I can say at this point.
It's Richard.
Yes.
Is it Richard?
Yeah, it's actually about Richard. Song for him, I suppose. But I haven't told him that yet.
Well, is there anyone that's got like one big idea, which is a ding 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 ding, and it like runs the whole way through, and it keeps it at that level of intensity, even though there are peaks and troughs. Whereas Put It Behind You seems to have a sort of, it's less like that. It's less. It feels it like
it doesn't build up a head of steam.
Yeah, exactly. Well, the bass is brilliant, and obviously, you know, the song itself. Yeah, I'll...